Lord, we lift up Pastor Mike this morning. We just ask that you would be with his words, Lord. We ask that you would open our hearts and our minds, and that what he has to say is what each and everyone needs to hear this morning, Lord. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, beloved. First of all, my thanks to the Piebinga family, or the For Him, for sitting in the front row. No, for that wonderful leading in worship this morning. That was a real treat. We feel, at least I know I feel, pretty spoiled these last couple of weeks. We've had that outdoor service where we had the children leading us in worship with their songs that they were learning this summer, which was a real treat. And then last week with our Community of Faith service, that was another great morning of worship, and with three in a row. So back to just us regulars next week. So mark it on your calendars, folks. We're going to begin a more in-depth look into the book of Jude this morning. So if you wanted to go ahead and find Jude and put your thumb there, it is the second to last book of the Bible. Right after 3 John. 3 John actually looks really short in comparison to Jude, so at least Jude looks like he'll give us some good food for thought throughout these next 6 to 8 weeks. But at our board meeting, we had a board meeting this past Thursday, Steve opened up and he read from 2 Timothy 3:16, which says, "All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness." And I know I need to be reminded sometimes of the simple facts of our faith from time to time, and that was a timely reminder for me. And actually, as I was sitting next to Elena, she has that verse this morning written out on her piece of paper. So I thought, what a reminder to me before I get to come up and share with you from God's Word that all Scripture is breathed out by God. Amen? Amen. All Scripture is breathed out by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. So that is going to be our goal every morning, and I was reminded afresh of that this morning when I consider what it is we're coming here to do. We're coming here to worship our risen Lord Savior Jesus Christ. And we see him as God chose to reveal him to us most clearly in the pages of Scripture. And I sometimes joke that most of my sermon is plagiarized because it comes from Bible, comes from the Bible. I'm plagiarizing the words of Scripture, which is a source that all pastors and all teachers should plagiarize from regularly, but not claim it as their own, of course. But that is the part of my sermon that you can rely on 100% is when I'm reading from God's Word. And I was reminded afresh of that this morning. As we begin to look at a book in greater detail, like we will with the book of Jude, it's a challenge to study the book to find out precisely what the writer was getting at. What does he want or she want his or her audience to know primarily? What is his intended audience? What is the intended meaning for his intended audience? And that's one of the ways that we approach a text. And so I'm usually a little bit nervous moving into a new book because these thoughts are afresh in my mind. And Jude has proved to be challenging for a number of reasons. One is there aren't a whole lot of historical indicators for us. So as we try to date the letter, when did Jude write this? That's been challenging. Best guesses are sometime around AD 60. So you're looking at approximately 30 years after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We know if that's the case that the church was pretty strong at this point. It was evident. And there were outposts of Christianity throughout that whole region as Christianity spread in the face of persecution. Interesting, right? Persecution, we fear it because that's a fear for our flesh. It's a fear for our well-being. But oftentimes that is the most fertile ground from which the birth of new converts is spawned. So we know that if that's the case, then Jude is writing in a time when Christianity is pretty prevalent, not without its persecutors, of course. This is not a cushy time for Christianity. This is very likely, it could even be around the time that Nero was lighting his gardens with the bodies of Christians. So as you think about the way you light our gardens, think about the way Nero lit his. I have made this remark before. I had a computer in college that the program that was burning my DVDs and CDs was called Nero. I had no clue at the time what an awful reference that is. Shame on the company for doing that. So this was not a cushy time for Christianity, but it was a time of a lot of new birth, a lot of time of people coming to saving faith in Jesus Christ. The other thing that when we think about approaching a letter for the first time is, what do we know about the author? And Jude has not left us with a ton of information, but I think he's left us with enough. Throughout the New Testament, there's a handful of Judases, if you will. Judas is actually, in the Greek text, is how we would translate how he refers to himself in verse 1. We have translated it, I believe the motivation behind just translating it as Jude would be to help us in our minds remove Iscariot from the equation. That would be, you know, the providing or the prevailing, we'll go with that word. That'd be the overriding consensus, we'll go that way. But Jude has not left us with a ton of information either as far as identity, but again, I think he's left us with enough. We talked a couple weeks ago that the major identifier here would be the fact that he is the brother of James. And if you are only known by one name, if you thought that by saying you're the brother of James, then the James that would have the most clout, if you will, would definitely be James, the brother of Jesus, who was the overriding, was the overseer of the church in Jerusalem. In Acts 15, he was overseeing the first Jerusalem council. So that would be a name that would carry weight that you wouldn't have to get a lot of descriptors on. So when Jude's identifying himself as the brother of James, it's a good idea. We can say with pretty good certainty that this would be the brother of Jesus, which would then make Jude also the brother of Jesus. Scholars, majority of which would agree with that line of thinking. And I think that that actually holds a good deal of water. I think that that's something that we can move forward with a great deal of confidence. And it also is remarkable then if we back up in Jude's first sentence that when he refers to himself as a servant of Jesus Christ, he isn't relying on his earthly relationship with Jesus to gain a hearing. He's not saying, I'm special because I'm Jesus' earthly brother. He's actually saying he's a servant of Jesus Christ. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second as well as in terms of how he has phrased that. So as we embark on this deep dive through the book of Jude for the next 7 or 8 weeks, I'm excited for the weeks to come. Studying Jude for this past month has let me know that I have often missed some of the more obvious points that Jude was trying to make. So probably being rude to you guys and thinking that you're like me, I hopefully will help maybe clear up some of those things that have bothered me. But I'm sure you and many of you will probably find them, duh, Pastor Mike, we knew that. But let's make clear the main things. So I'm excited to work through what Jude was telling his original audience as we can apply it to ourselves today and what that can mean for you and me and the church of Jesus Christ today. The theme verse for Jude, or the central argument I believe that he is trying to make, is found in Jude 3. Jude 3 reads, "Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints." We can stand firm on our faith because it was once for all delivered. We are not waiting for more revelation. In fact, if anyone claims to have new revelation, we could say that they are in error. We may be freshly inspired by what is existing for us in the 66 pages of the canon of Scripture, the rule of Scripture, but we are not waiting for Revelation Part 2 to come through as far as proven text that we then nail on the back of our Bibles and call book number 67. We have the faith once for all delivered to the saints and brothers and sisters, friends, beloved, you are saints. This is the faith once for all delivered to you and to me. And that we do well to know more about what it is our Lord and Savior has for us, especially as we see it coming from the corrective hand of Jude here in this letter. So my prayer, as always, as I approach studying and writing out sermons, is that I'm 100% faithful to the text, meaning that I'm honest with the language of the author, and I give due diligence to understanding the original context, to what the author was intending for his original audience, if you will, to hear and to know. And as such, Jude, Tim, and Abby had the great pleasure of walking in at a time where I did repent of this, but I was frustrated with Jude. I was glad they came in, actually, because he was killing me with this four-letter word in our English language in verse 1, kept for Jesus. But Jude has a handle on the Greek language that is very precise, and it's very, actually, it's pretty high-level Greek. It's still Koine Greek. You'll hear that term mentioned. It means street Greek. How great is it that our Greek New Testament is written in the language of the people, not the erudite? But Jude has some, maybe a little bit of the erudite in him, because he introduces about 18 Greek words that are never, ever used before in the Greek New Testament. So for me, who's just has the seminary Greek study, not and struggling with some of that, like I'm loving the simple Greek, love John, but Jude was just killing me with some of these words, and Tim and Abby came in, and I think God, in his providence, allowed that to be the case to say, stop it, stop being frustrated, because this is beautiful. What's there that is simple is what can carry you through. But not just the 18 new words in the Greek New Testament that he has added, he also uses 21 or 22 other Greek words that are very rare. So in 20, how many verses do we have? 25. About a new word a verse. Like, so I told Tim, joking, I said, I cannot wait to see Jude in heaven. But I really can't, because I'm going to thank him for challenging me. And when we look at what his ultimate goal, he's not here challenging our understanding of the Greek language. He's challenging whatever church this may be to work, to live, to worship, to be the body of Christ as Christ would have us to be. And if we think that this is about AD 60, then this church very well could be 20 to 30 years old at this point. And in that, and I will say short, in that relatively short amount of time, the amount of correction that Jude packs in 25 verses is staggering. But at the same time, we can also look at all of the ways, and we will over the next handful of weeks, we'll look at the ways that he's correcting this church, calling the church to faithfulness in Jesus Christ. We can also say that there's probably not one point of origin for every single one of these teachers. I don't think, and a lot of you, as you approach this text, will probably feel the same way. I don't think it was one teacher that came in and just skewed everything morally and ethically in their behavior and caused them to stray away from how Christ would have us to live, or as he would call the body of Christ to exist. I think that this shows potentially a lack of discernment that we are all at risk of participating in. And so for my call and the theme verse of this letter, and for our theme verse for the series, will be that verse 3, which is that we are going to appeal to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints, and to see how this church in Jerusalem, whatever its makeup was, more than likely was predominantly Jewish, to see how we can apply that for us today. This is not merely just to know God's word and to use it as trivial knowledge, but to apply it to how we live in the body of Christ today. So please stand with me as we read just the first four verses of Jude in honor of the Word of God, as we prepare to be encouraged, beloved, as we contend for the faith. Jude 1 begins, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. May mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And Father, we thank you for the focus on who Jesus Christ is and who he's called to be as set apart people, as saints. Lord, how he's called us to behave and to interact within the body of Christ. Lord, may we get our own house in order, and may we be challenged afresh, and may we be looking at our own ways through discerning eyes, Lord, because of how Jude inspired his original audience. Father, may the rest of our time here this morning be such that we are looking at who Christ is as our ultimate aim, the one whom we worship, the one whom we love, the one who has just poured out his mercy upon us, Lord. Father, may we honor who Jesus is through the reading and preaching of his word and the hearing and doing of it that follows. It's in his matchless name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. So as we talked about a couple weeks ago, we can safely assume again that Jude is the author of the letter, the brother, the earthly brother of our Lord Jesus Christ. We also know that from biblical data that he very likely did not come to faith while Jesus was yet alive. That may have even been a product of him being his earthly brother. Like, all right, Jesus, you're doing some pretty amazing things, but come on, big brother. We kind of said it lightheartedly a couple weeks ago, but truthfully, to have a brother or sister that never sinned, difficult shoes to walk in afterwards. Immediately, I wonder, this is clearly subjection here, but I wonder how often Mary and Joseph said, Jude, really? Jesus never did that. I mean, I don't know, but it makes you wonder, and I wonder if that played into the fact that Jude, we don't have any record of the fact that he came to faith before Jesus died, before he was risen from the ground, risen from the grave, risen from the grip of death, showing himself to be victorious over death, showing himself to be victorious over sin, living the perfect life. So I think it's pretty, I don't point a whole lot of fingers at Jude if he didn't come to faith until after Christ was raised from the dead, because he would be in the same category as a majority of those who will be within heaven. And as we try to figure out who this Jude is, we know that there was other Judases, so I believe James to be the deciding factor for us there. And I think that James's influence would be such that he could be mentioned with one mention of his name. So when he identifies himself as the brother of James, I believe that's done so to an audience more than likely within the region of Jerusalem, that region could be far-reaching. Jude, the letter of Jude, was actually accepted more often in churches in that region and into North Africa as it was copied over and into the many manuscripts that we have existing of it today. And it was in that region that they really readily accepted the book of Jude. It did come under some scrutiny, but it has always had, at the very least, a very strong hearing. So we look at this and we say, how is Jude identifying himself in this first verse? Because a greeting of letter of this type, they often identify themselves. They don't wait for the salutation at the end. The greeting identifies the sender. And he calls himself a servant of Jesus Christ. We're about 2,000 years removed from the bond servanthood system of that age. And we also have the historical baggage of the term servant slave in our own culture. But when you listen to those words coming out of the mouth of a Jewish man in the first century, it actually carries with it a very strong import to its original audience. A man firmly comfortable with the Old Testament and other traditional Jewish writings would use this phrasing, a servant of, enter another name, very seriously. Moses and David often were referred to, or in talking about themselves, referred to themselves as servants of Yahweh or Lord. In your Old Testament, that would be the big capital L and the lower capital O-R-D, the holy covenant name of God, Yahweh. Servants of, enter name Yahweh. We can see that in Joshua 1, verses 1 and 2, when referring to Moses' death, he's referred to as a servant of the Lord. Or in Psalm 89, where the Lord made his covenant with David, he calls him his servant of the Lord. So when Jude, a Jewish man, calls himself a servant of Jesus Christ, he's changing really a divine formula for that original audience. If they were hearing this letter read, which very likely they were, they didn't have forwarding and emails. You wouldn't have to dig this one out of the spam folder. Delta Community Church joke. That's where all my emails go. And they claim it's on accident. This would likely have been read, and more than likely, if they were listening with attentive ears and the reader was reading this to this original church, they probably would have heard Jude, a servant of, and they probably said in their minds, Yahweh, servant of the Lord. And here Jude goes and says, a servant of Jesus Christ. Now, I don't want you to underline this verse and say that this is proof of Jesus' divinity and that he's a member of the Godhead. We can't go that far, but when we look at the context in which this letter was written, this was a very strong statement that he's making. And I love that fact that this would catch the ears of his Jewish audience or even those familiar with the Jewish tradition and the Jewish scriptures. And they go, here is a person who is really putting Jesus Christ on par with God. And he's saying, as Jesus' servant or slave, that Jude is being obedient to Jesus' call upon his life. And he wants to contend for that faith once for all delivered to you and me, the saints. Jude's greeting continues, and he's identified himself. Now in the second half of verse 1, he identifies his audience. To those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. We'll see this over a dozen times in this short letter, where Jude loves using triplets, where he loves using the adding on, the expanding of a meaning or an intended focus of a phrase that he's trying to get across by doing it with three different descriptors. We have it at least once here in this first verse where he says that you are called, you are beloved, and you are kept. We'll see it again in verse 2 also. So Jude's greeting continues, and he's telling and he's identifying his audience of who they are. There's lots of theories about where this church existed. Again, it all depends upon where you think that Jude and James would have had one name importance. But I wonder also if this may have been a circuit letter. Because there isn't the church of Galatia, the church of Colossae. He identifies those that are being addressed here as those who are called, beloved, and kept for Jesus Christ. This would have an amazing wide audience across that region. And as you go through, and if you listen through about verse 17, he kind of lists the ways that they have gone astray or they've let error come in. This would have import across many, many churches. Yet it is the once for all faith delivered to the saints that they are to contend for. Many problems, one answer would be my point. He's writing to those who are called. This is another staggering and comforting reality in Scripture. God calls people. He initiates. He pursues. He beckons people. And we come because he called. The epitome, the highest substance of unconditional love is that God called us in Christ Jesus, and he did so while we were yet sinners. Amen? There is comfort in that. And it could just be that Jude's letter, which serves as a strong condemnation, maybe too strong of a word, but there is correction here, a strong correction, that he leads off his letter with encouragement. You've been called by the Lord. So there's a strong encouragement that accompanies his strong warning, and that I believe is a helpful rhythm for even you and I. As we think or seek to correct somebody, that we do so from a spirit of love. Yes, we speak truth, and sometimes that's hard to hear. 2 Timothy 3:16 lets us know that God's scripture, being him breathed, is profitable for reproof and correction. But not just called, they are, that's the first of Jude's first triplet here, but beloved and kept. We are called, we are loved, and we are kept in God the Father by the Holy Spirit and for Jesus Christ. And lest you think you can rest your morality, your public or private ethic, if you will, and walk in life any way you would like, just because you're kept, sometimes that can be the knee-jerk reaction. I want to make sure we get that out of the way for the whole course of this letter, and turn to verse 21 of Jude. Because he gives us here an encouragement for our own commitment in keeping ourselves. Because in verse 21 he also says, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. So throughout this letter and the parts that we've just skipped over that we'll talk about, there's strong corrections, strong warnings, if you will, but there is the you are kept and you keep yourself. There's the divine sovereignty, the providential hand of God which called and calls you beloved and keeps you, and yet there's also the responsibility to keep yourself. Don't let your moral guard down. Don't let the morality of the world call you to live such a life that affects your witness. Because in reality, that's what's going on here. The church, wherever Jude is writing, is losing their witness because they look just like the world. Their morality looks no different, more than likely, at least it's creeping in. And Jude's saying, warning, full stop. We need to get this under control because we need to contend, which is an athletic term, which means struggle, exert energy, contend for the faith. And he says, contend for the faith, not contend for morality. Because the more we contend for our faith that Jesus Christ has given us, the more we will live how he wants us to live. And this is an admonition to the church. Jude isn't writing to the surrounding culture. Because Jude's not surprised when a pig who's washed walks back into the pig slop and gets muddy again. That's what pigs do. To use a farming analogy, I'm not really calling everyone that's not saved a pig. I bet he looks relieved. Jude's not calling. He's not, this whole letter's not written to the culture. He doesn't expect the culture to live like Christ. They don't know him, but you who are called, beloved, and kept. In verse 21, also keep yourself. Be different. You're saints. The term saints means you're called and set apart. You're holy. Just like the instruments that were used in the temple and the tabernacle, all of the systems and the religious mechanisms of that age were set apart for a specific person's purpose. You too are set apart for a specific purpose. And in that keeping of yourself, isn't it wonderful that he lets us know what our ultimate hope is? Waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. That yes, at some point in the great glorious future, no longer will we be contending against those outside forces. No longer will your enemy who prowls around like a roaring lion waiting for someone to devour. No longer will he use what gets your sinful juices flowing to try to stray you, to pull you away from who Christ has called you to be. There is that glorious future that we have to look forward to. That empowers and encourages our contending for the faith. So this letter, I've often been excited when I get to Jude, especially if it's like one of those Bible reading plans, because it's like Jude marks how close. I can put that on my spiritual resume. Another year, another Bible. Big whoop if you don't know what it means. And that's what that can be the danger of a Bible reading plan as well, if we can start to check boxes. But I have flown through Jude way too many times. In fact, if you would have asked me before studying this, what's the main focus of Jude, I maybe could have pulled out the whole contending for the faith. But I wouldn't have looked at all these different pieces and seen Jude's personality that God has used and had him affect my life. Because at the end of the day, we still are reading someone else's mail. This was addressed to an original audience, maybe a circuit of churches. But by its inclusion in the canon of Scripture, it's also, at the very least, intended for my eyes. And that's the beauty of Scripture. It transcends cultural differences. It transcends advancements in technology. And it's as applicable to me today as it was to that original audience. And it's up for us to look at this and to see how we can be called to become more and more like Christ. And trust me, as we get into this letter, Jude is very, very relevant today. So Jude has awakened his audience's eyes by calling himself a servant of Jesus Christ. He's identified himself with his brother James. He's addressed this letter to those who are called, beloved, and kept. They're called, beloved, in God the Father, kept for Jesus Christ. In verse 2, he says, may mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. I think the phrase that I love the most, well, don't get me wrong, mercy, peace, and love are amazing, but be multiplied to you. It's not a singular dose of mercy, peace, and love. It's not like there's a snack bar and there's the mercy cookie and you gotta grab one. And you grab one and then let it be multiplied. Let it be growing among you. And he's talking to the body of Christ. And when we think about how that applies to the body of Christ, that means that as we are shown mercy, peace, and love, we show it. And as we say here an awful lot, we're conduits of those things. We aren't the terminal end. We're not the outlet from which that just, we get to absorb and use the mercy, peace, and love of our God the Father, but we are the conduit. We receive it and we share it, and it becomes multiplied as we engage with contending for the faith because of who we are, called, beloved, and kept for Jesus Christ. So may we regard the mercy, peace, and love of God in Jesus Christ all the more as we walk through the pages of Scripture. And we see this ancient text being applicable to us today. One author wrote this, of this verse. He said, may we know God's mercy more intimately, his peace more completely, and his love more firmly. that may be one way we can multiply those glorious truths. So now we've identified the sender, hopefully, the recipient, his main goal. His verse 3 gives us this contention that he is fighting for. Beloved, although I was eager to write to you about our common salvation, I think that we can safely say that he had an idea of writing to this church to encourage them, which I believe still bleeds through even in this letter. It is still an encouraging admonition. So he had another idea in mind. He wanted to write to these churches or church and to say, I wanted to encourage you, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, maybe even to shore up the doctrinal pilings that these churches were being built on, the common salvation, the one thing we have in common, especially when we think about Galatians, there is no longer slave, nor free, Jew, nor Gentile, common salvation. He lets us know in verse 3, I found it necessary to write appealing to you, to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. This is a letter written to the church, to the body of Christ, those who gather regularly to worship the risen Lamb, the Son who through his blood purchased redemption for those who trust in him. As we mentioned before, this is not a screed against culture and society and their sinfulness. No, this is written to the church, a call of people who are set apart for something different, to be a light in the darkness, to be salt in the world. And he lets us know in verse 4, really, he takes that purpose statement to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. And then he tells us why in verse 4. This is kind of introducing what we'll look at in really 5 through 17 at a later date. Verse 4, he says, for certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. We are an open and welcoming church, right? We want to see people come and hear the good news, come and observe and see lives changed. But at the same time, we do have to keep an eye on their influence, especially when it comes to doctrine and how we are showing and worshiping and following ourselves as walking in the footsteps of our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ at the end of verse 4. Because certain people can creep in. So it's important for us to be mindful of that, but to also live in such a way that shows allegiance to who Christ is. So this church or churches have allowed certain people to creep in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation. That can be a troubling phrase. I've heard and read different understandings of what that long ago were designated for this condemnation means. It very well could mean, it could be referring to merely, and I say merely, God's sovereignty, his omniscience, as if that's merely. It's quite a large thing. It could be referring to the fact that God knew that these people would perform their tasks, if you will, creep in unnoticed. Other people say that's a reference to the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm not sure exactly what it means, but I think that it shows that what they were doing was contrary to the style of life that God has called them for. So there's certain people have crept in unnoticed who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality, and that really becomes his main focus as we'll go through the rest of this letter. They pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. So yes, we walk differently. Yes, we live differently. And we don't do so from a legalistic standpoint to earn God's salvation. We know that to be the case. Paul makes that abundantly clear for us. Especially when we look at Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. By grace we're saved, right? We don't do and perform certain things. It's a gift so that we can't even boast about it. But we don't want to fall into the category of perverting the grace of our God into sensuality. That would be going back to the kept for in verse 1 and just abusing it. Well, if I'm kept by Jesus, I can just keep on doing this and that. And it's difficult because at times I've heard it said before, like, I just wish there was a list of sins we can't do in the Bible. And you can argue that there's vice lists. But in reality, there is just this lifestyle that says if it's not honoring who God is, if it's not glorifying God, then should we be doing it? Should we be participating in it? I think when we make that our mindset, when we make honoring the grace of our God and not denying our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ, that helps us into making that ethical or moral decisions. Because we are called and set apart people. Called and set apart for a specific purpose. To share and to minister the gospel of Jesus Christ. To help people who are hurting. To help those who are struggling in an area where Satan has got a hold on them. Maybe even a chokehold, telling them it's okay to pervert the grace of God. We need to be a hospital for those that are hurting, not a museum of perfected saints, because if we were, we'd be counterfeit. We need to show and to be called and set apart people. And Jude will move through this as he progresses through the rest of this letter. And I think that what he's also getting at here is that we're not meant to be merely heresy hunters. We're not supposed to just always look for the wrong in people or you know, keeping our eye. I mean, we let the for him come into the church. But you guys didn't creep in unannounced. You were very announced. So we have to be careful with the discernment, though. We want to make sure that we're not being ultra discerning, if you will. But we need to be loving and welcoming, but also being knowing that we're, and finding this balance, knowing that we're called and set apart people who do not pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. And I think that's where he takes this servant of Jesus Christ of verse 1 and hammers it home. There is one Master servant. There is one Lord, Jesus Christ. If you have your Bibles open, flip over to John 14, and that's where we'll conclude our time this morning. John 14, it's an interesting time in Jesus' ministry. He's preparing for the crucifixion, if you will. This is the upper room discourse. You'll hear these chapters referred to that, and it's some of Jesus' final concentrated teachings to his disciples, really in a disciple-only context as well. This is not one of his large mountainside teachings. This is specifically for his disciples. At the end of John 13, just so we get the context, in verse 36, Jesus is... I'll just relate the narrative of John, tell us the story. John 13, 36, Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" And Jesus answered him, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now. But you will follow afterward." That's that end of verse 21 of Jude, that hope that we have of eternal life in Christ. Confusing to the mindset because Simon Peter didn't have John to read. So he's learning this. He's hearing this for the first time. Verse 37, Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you." Jesus answered, "Will you lay down your life for me? Truly, truly, I say to you, the rooster will not crow till you have denied me three times." In John 14, "Let not your hearts be troubled." Correction, encouragement. You wonder where Jude learned this. "Believe in God. Believe also in me," Jesus says. Verse 2, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I would have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, and that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." Verse 5, Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jude is almost playing out for us exactly what these verses mean for us, especially verse 6, Jesus saying, "I am the way." There is a way in which we walk. We walk in the way that God has called us to. We'll all have different cultural context. Christianity at its cultural intersection may look different in Zambia than it does in America, but ultimately we're serving the same God, the only Lord and sovereign, Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is the way, and that's what Jude's calling him for. He is the truth. Jesus will not lie. He just gave an example of it. "If I wasn't going, would I have even told you I'm going to this place where I'm going to have many rooms for you?" And he is the life. He's how we have the promise of hope evermore, how we have the promise of glory to come, the fact that our sins can and are forgiven, and that we can walk in this newness of life. Everyone loves the first half of John 14:6, but not many people like the last part where he says, no one comes to the Father except through me. The exclusive nature of salvation by Jesus Christ alone is only offensive if we don't tell others about it. It's not something we're supposed to keep. It's something we're supposed to share, to spread, and to sow those seeds of gospel in, whether it's a high school friend at a coffee shop or whether it's a heart-to-heart, face-to-face, Bibles open, witnessing with someone else. It transcends all of these situations. We can be, as John MacArthur says, you may be the only Bible that somebody may ever read. We can be that life to somebody as we share what Christ has done to us, because we aren't the terminal end. We aren't the fruit that bears no more. We are the fruit that should go on bearing fruit. We aren't the light switch at the end of the circuit. We're just part of the conduit that keeps the glory of Jesus Christ being known 2,000 years later. And in the face of relatively very little persecution, although some could argue increasing, and may continue to increase. So may we strengthen ourselves now. May we encourage ourselves now when we can come to church without being threatened to stop, or to say it's illegal, or to say you can only do it on Sundays. May we encourage and embolden and work those persecution-resisting muscles now, so that when it comes, we can stand up strong in the face of it. Jude's letter is a letter of encouragement, ultimately. Yes, there's correction, but it's done so in love because of who we worship. If you didn't catch it, the first verse of Jude, he mentions Jesus Christ twice. That is our central aim and focus. That's the one whom we want to walk to please. That's the one whom we worship, and that's the one whom we share. Because he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one will come to the Father except through him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that there are strong voices, Lord, that serve as correction to the church. Father, here at Delton Community Church, or even those churches that are represented by those sitting here this morning, Lord, may we never get so comfortable to think that we've got it all figured out and that we're doing everything right. But Lord, may we always seek to do things in more in closer alignment with your will, specifically as it's spelled out for us in the pages of Scripture. But Father, may we never lose sight of the fact that what is spelled out in the pages of Scripture is the fact that you have shown us forgiveness and love and mercy in Jesus Christ. That him being the perfect man, fully man, lived the perfect sinless life and could stand then as our substitute, and being fully God, Lord, he could stand up to your eternal wrath, saving us from the wrath to come. Not merely, Lord, so that you could stamp us forgiveness in dullable ink or erasable lead, but Lord, you stamped us as forgiven, Lord, kept by Jesus Christ and for him. And Lord, in between that moment and when we meet you face to face, we want to contend and to keep ourselves. And we guard our hearts. Keep us aligned with the true faith of Jesus Christ expressed in Scripture, Lord. Father, I petition you now to erase from the ears in this room this morning any of my error. And Lord, where truth has been spoken, may that find a resting spot in their hearts as we all walk to become more and more like Christ. And it's in his precious name we pray. Amen.